So, Carole Westerkamp is... Come on, you can woot away. Okay. So, her slides will be up very soon. And Carole is going to speak about the magic of metaphor. And you've got a longer title, but I'm not going to read it. I'm going to let you explain. Okay, so here we go. Right, so I'll give this to you.
Yes, I would prefer. I prefer this mic over the other one because I don't want to be standing rooted to the table. So for those of you who don't know me, my name is Carole Westerkamp. I'm a secondary school teacher of English and German, and I'm also an NLP trainer, neuro-linguistic programming. And I've had quite a lot of questions before my speech, which hasn't even started yet. What are you going to talk about? You know, storytelling? Yes. It's not TPRS, teaching proficiency through reading and storytelling, which is a technique that started in the States. It was started by Blaine Ray and his son Celie Ray. This is not about technique. This is about storytelling. I have a book here, and it's called Milica je prosta. And I'm not going to read from the book. It's just a prop. Like, you know, why do people tell stories? Well, the first slide, I'll let you read a few things before I start my storytelling. The first slide says, metaphor, the right brain's unique contribution to the left brain's language capability. This is from a book. Oh, and I see now that I made a spelling error. Ooh, wow. The Alphabet versus the Goddess. It's a very interesting book by Leonard Slane, in which he says that at a certain point, humankind started using written language, most of all, and any language at all is the left side of the brain. And you've been using that, well, all morning and probably all the time when you are learning languages. And I'm here to tell you that maybe it's a good idea to also involve the right side of your brain. Because the right side of the brain is the side of the brain where we have our emotions and our creativity and all those kind of things. And it's very good to use that in language learning. I heard a lot of stories this morning in which people talk about difficulties. The word difficulty is not a word I like because it is a supposition. It supposes that something is going to be difficult. So how on earth is it ever going to get easy if you have the belief that it's going to be difficult? Well, that's where storytelling comes in. You can tell people stories of things that might have looked not so easy, and you can hear that I don't use the word difficult. I use the word easy negatively, but not yet easy, which supposes that it's going to become easy very soon. And that's also what the NLP, the neuro-linguistic programming, does. It kind of preps you to find things easy. It preps you to be more efficient. Another thing in storytelling is motivation. You can motivate people by telling them stories that might motivate them. And then you think, oh yeah, sure, well, they've been telling me stories for ages, but maybe just not the right stories. Maybe stories that went to your left side of the brain, while I am here to tell you that it's a good idea to tell stories that go to the right side of the brain. So, are you ready for the magic? Yeah, the right side of the brain. We are all very curious people, aren't we? I think language learners might be even more curious than, oh, I need this, of course, than other people. I'll tell you a story about curiosity. I had a relationship with a really nice guy. Not that nice, because the relationship ended. But at the time, he was a very nice guy, and I was very much in love. And my birthday was coming closer and closer. And then, all of a sudden, he came home one day and he said, I bought you this present, and he held up a little black box, which I immediately recognized as a black box from the jeweler shop. So I thought, oops, yeah, that's nice. And he said, but your birthday is only in 3 days, so I'm not going to tell you, I'm not going to show you what is in it. I thought, okay, fair enough, I can stand that. So he put it on the television. Nowadays that wouldn't work because the screens are so flat. But he put it on this, you know, this huge television. And he said, I'm sure you're going to look into the box before your birthday is there. And I said, no. I can stand this. I'm strong and I can withstand the temptation. I'm sure, he said, and he went off to work. So I thought, well, he's not here now. No, I'm not going to do that. I don't want him to, you know, think that he's right. I never want him to think he's right, no. I don't want him to think he's right, so I'm not going to look in that box. And I was free that day, so I tried to keep myself busy. And after about half an hour or an hour, I don't know, I went over to the television and I took the box and I thought, no. I'm strong, and I put back the box. And then after about another hour, and I really had tried to keep myself very busy with things that I don't like doing and with things that I do like doing, and I went back to the television and I took the box and I opened it and I couldn't believe my eyes. So what storytelling is about is like things like this. You know, what do you think they do with TV series? I've recently learned that Dr. House is very popular in all of Europe. I mean, I've met some Romanians who said, yeah, the movie, you know, the TV series Dr. House. Today my host, I'm couch surfing here, said, yeah, Dr. House. I was like, whoa, Dr. House is everywhere. But Dr. House has a story and it ends. It begins and it ends. But there are lots of series, and I don't really know what series you watch in all of the countries you're from, but lots of series cut the story at, well, the moment you think, oh God, I'll have to watch tomorrow as well. Or it takes a week even. You know, in Holland, I don't watch much television, but I watched the series Nikita. And every time that I thought, yeah, now they're gonna tell me what this, you know, what the plot is, then it finished. And it was only once a week. And I was like, shoot, damn, you know, I have to wait a whole week before I will know. And then they started another story. That effect is called the Scheherazade effect. Well, I see people nodding, so that means you know the story of Scheherazade. The story of Scheherazade is about, I think it's Persian in origin. There's this caliph, or, you know, high-placed man, who was betrayed in his marriage, and he beheaded his wife. And then he thought, I'm never going to marry again. I will just ask, like, concubine or girl, woman, to come up every evening and we'll do whatever I want to do with her and then I'll just kill her again. So, yay! There was this woman, Scheherazade, daughter of a also high-placed person, who was very intelligent, very well-read, very educated, and she volunteered. And her father was very angry at her. No, don't do that. Yes, she said, trust me. She agreed with her sister that her sister, she would ask the man of whom we are speaking to wait a moment in killing her or doing anything else, but she wanted to say goodbye to her sister, and he granted her that favor. So the sister said, well, before you say goodbye, I would like you to tell me a story. So she started telling a story, and time went on, the night passed. She hadn't been killed yet. It's difficult to tell stories when you're dead. And in the morning, she broke off the story. And her, well, husband, you can't really say, but he was like, well, how does it end? Yeah, she said, sorry, but daylight has come, and I'll tell you, I'll finish the story this evening. So he had spared her life this one evening. And the next evening, she actually finished the first story, but she started another story. And when dawn came, she stopped the story. She had been saved two nights already. And that went on and on and on, and I won't tire you with all the details, which I don't really know either, but after 1,001 nights, she said, well, I have no more stories. So, yeah, that was it. But the guy was so enthralled with her stories that he said, okay, actually, I've fallen in love with you. I want you to marry me. And they married and lived happily ever after. It's just to prove the point that once a story hasn't been finished, and I'm not an academic, so I don't have all kinds of slides with numbers to prove it, but it has been proven that the brain retains unfinished stories better. Now, you might say, what has that to do with language learning? Because if I tell you, like, okay, I'll tell you tomorrow what apple is in Croatian, you say, oh, yeah, sure, well, great. No, it's not about that. It's about telling stories, and they can be very short, that arouse people's curiosity. It's about telling stories that motivate people. It reminds me of another story, actually. There were three or four very young mice playing around, you know, behind the, don't even know what it's called, but behind the wall somewhere in their little house with the mama mouse together. And she kind of said, okay, you're now at the age that we can venture outside. So they were walking through the room in the house, and they were playing and squeaking and, you know, squealing with delight. And all of a sudden there was this ominous shadow. Big black cat was standing there or waiting to attack them, the yellow eyes flaming, and you could see all that he was thinking, his teeth were dripping with saliva. And you could see he was thinking, there's my lunch. And suddenly, out of the blue, the mother mouse jumps over and says, ruff, 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 ruff. And the cat got scared off. And their mother mouse said, you see how it can come in handy to know another language. Now, this is one of the stories I tell my students at school, just as an example. There's another example. There are Americans in the room, aren't there? It's about an American president, so I won't say who it was, I don't even know. There's an American president who goes with one of his advisors somewhere in New Mexico, and they're having lunch. And he's looking at the menu, thinking, oh, I don't know. Then over comes the waitress, and the president says, excuse me, I think I'll have a quickie. And the waitress is appalled, like, How dare you? I don't care who you are, but I don't want you to use that language with me. And the president is kind of puzzled. And then his advisor leans over and says, excuse me, sir, but I think here they pronounce it a quiche. So, another story about pronunciation. Why could pronunciation be important? It always reminds me of more stories, of course. There's also a story about grammar. Some people are very into grammar, and some people are less into grammar. Like, why should it be important? And what I'm doing now is I'm showing you how stories work, but you shouldn't actually give away the clue of the story before you tell it. It's up to everybody in the room, but still, since I'm a kind of teaching and not. This story is about two guys, they're friends. One of them is a businessman, he has quite a lot of money, and he owns a boat, so he invites his friend, a teacher, teachers like me, you know, not so much money, to go on a tour on the boat, so okay. And then the businessman, at a certain point, he looks at the sky and he looks at the water and he says, I think we're gonna have a storm. And the teacher is appalled. He said, well, come on, that's not grammarly correct. It's not correct grammar. You should say, we are having a storm, not we's having a storm. What is that? You wasted half your life if you haven't learned any grammar. Well, the businessman just shrugs it off. So, in about half an hour time, clouds get darker and darker, thunder, lightning, the sea's getting wilder and wilder. And then the businessman says to the teacher, do you know how to swim? No, says the teacher. Why should I learn how to swim? Well, says the businessman with a kind of a smile on his face, he says, then you've wasted your whole life because we's are gonna drown. You're getting it, the stories? Yeah. Let me see what's on my next slide. Oh yeah. It also says that that's Einstein. He said that the rational mind is the faithful servant. The intuitive mind is a sacred gift. The paradox of modern life is that we have begun to worship the servant and defile the divine. And I think that's true. which is why last year in Budapest I volunteered to speak of the power of words, which is more or less the same, because we're so into the left brain and we kind of, well, worship it. I think very many people in the room here and also in the other room probably, but they're all asking about, you know, methods, mythology and things like that. And then I was glad with Josip and Badvomio, I hope I say the name right, yeah, speaking about, you know, motivation. Motivation is indeed very important. You can't really motivate yourself with your left brain. I mean, if that were so, there would be a lot of things that I would have now, like lots of money or lots of whatever, you know. You can't. The motivation is in your right brain. So by storytelling and by working around the left brain, you work around resistance. I use stories every day, and I'm afraid some of you have already noticed that. Yesterday I told someone who's a very, very nice person, a great guy, but who always thinks of others before he thinks of himself. I said, you know, I came here by airplane. Well, so did he, by the way, but we weren't on the same plane. And I said to him, you know what they always say when they're doing their things with the mask and the safety belts? If there is a drop in pressure in the cabin, the mask will fall out. You have to attach it, well, this way and the other. What do they say then? First yourself, yes. Well, that's a beautiful metaphor. It's a beautiful metaphor to use for people who always think of the others first. Even with small kids, people are very inclined to first try to help their kids, but you can't help them if you're out of breath and you're kind of fainting. So first take care of yourself. That's another beautiful metaphor. Maybe it doesn't have to do with stories, storytelling or teaching actually that much, but yes, I think so. Anything you can think of is a good story, especially in your own life. I tell stories in my class, especially when I want kids not to laugh at each other, because shame in high school is number one, actually. The image you have, who are you? You don't want to make a fool out of yourself. And I heard Josip and, gosh, there's the name again, Bartomeu. I say quickly so you won't hear my not correct pronunciation. I heard them saying that, you know, you want to go up to someone and you make mistakes. The word mistake, I was discussing this with Claudio, saying, why should you say, don't be afraid to make mistakes? What happens when I tell you, don't think of the pink elephant? It's a very famous example, so sometimes I think I should maybe use another one, but it's good. What do you think of if I say, don't think of the pink elephant? You think of the pink elephant. That's the way our brain works. You have to conjure up some image to be able to deny it. I also often say, well, I go to the supermarket regularly. What do I have on my paper? I don't have on my paper no cheese today, no potatoes, no shampoo, no soap, no... What do I have on the paper? My goals. I have on the paper what I do want. So, instead of saying, don't be afraid of making mistakes, you don't say it, Claudio, everybody else, think, what can you say instead of don't be afraid of making mistakes? Well, make mistakes, that wouldn't be my advice, but dare to make mistakes. Embrace your mistakes because you can learn from them. A metaphor for trial and error is walking. They used another example this morning, but I always tell my students, look, if you would have stopped learning to walk as a child because you fell over, nobody would walk. Right? And I go a bit further sometimes because there was like, yeah, well, my mom didn't order my books, so I don't have books. And then I'm like, okay, so if I would carry my kids around all day, first of all, I'd have a hernia, but, you know, they wouldn't have learned how to walk. So I think I use metaphors all the time. The general use of stories is not only to teach It's also just for pleasure. I mean, people like stories. That's the way we're wired. That's why stories were always told. That's even why we watch movies. Although it's more visual culture, but okay. Sometimes they can be used to surprise people. Like, I might have surprised you with a waff, waff, waff. The third one is to change the mood state or energy level of a person or group. If I start telling you a really sad story of all my failures and all my miseries in life, and believe me, I'm not as young as Josip and Bartolomeo, I'm making this difficult for myself every time, then, then I have made a lot of mistakes and things like that. So if I start telling you about all those, I'm afraid that the mood here would be like, oh, you know, lacking energy, lacking motivation. And that's not what I want. I want the motivation to get higher, and I want people to laugh and feel happy. So those are the kind of stories I need to tell. You agree upon that? Okay, now, a more specific use of the story is what I just did when I told you about my birthday present. You still don't know what was in the box. Open a loop, you awaken the brain, and you install information into open minds. And this, as I said, this has been proven to be true. It is true that once the brain is open, people will subconsciously, and that's what we want, be listening to see, to hear, is she finishing this story that I want to hear the end of? And I'm not telling. In the trainings I give, the NLP trainings, a lot of people even come to me and they say, well, you know, what happens? Calm down, I'll tell you in due time. So then they keep thinking, oh, I have to pay attention because, you know, it might come now.
But don't wait for too long, people get frustrated.
Yeah, well, that's also a lesson for me, that I know who are the easily frustrated people. Joke. You see, I'm used to teaching adolescents, and I make these feeble jokes because I'm like old. And they're like, oh, 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 very funny, teacher. So in order not to frustrate them, I kind of laugh ahead of them and say, yeah, funny, ha, ha. I know it's not funny, but okay. Okay, you can teach a point indirectly, which could be the case in the story I told about the teacher. You know, like, don't be too eager to point out people's grammatical errors, because, well, first of all, you're not perfect yourself, I think. If anybody's 100% perfect here, raise your hand. Yeah, they pulled it back really quickly. You can also shift the brain activity from beta waves, which is the conscious processing, to the alpha waves, which is a light trance or daydream state. Now, many people think hypnosis is like really weird, like, oh my God, they're going to call me on stage and then I'll be flapping my arms like a chicken or undressing or doing weird things. No, I believe that you're all often in a very light state of trance. For instance, when you walk or ride a bicycle or drive to your work or to any place well known and your thoughts are on something else, sometimes you're like, whoa, I arrived. And you didn't consciously turn left, right, go over the bridge, whatever you have to do daily, right? You're in a kind of a trance. Same goes, well, especially for me when I read books. I mean, you can shoot off a cannon next to me and I wouldn't notice. I guess that's a bit exaggerated, but I am very much into the book, so that is a trance. You recognize this? Yeah? Okay. And you install information on a deeper level. And I'm not installing any language learning in you now, but you know that this is also what they do in certain advertisements on TV commercials. There's kind of a quick line or a word or something, and you haven't even seen it. And it does register at a subconscious level. We're not even aware of half the things we, well, subconsciously see. So it is used, and it's also used in all kinds of tests where, for instance, you give people my age, our age, I'm not going to say old people, you give them all kinds of tests, but the phrasing is like very negative. So it's, for instance, they test your knowledge in how to say in Swahili, old people walk very slowly. I don't know Swahili, but so I don't know the translation, but okay, that kind of sentences, or people over 50 take approximately 3 years longer to learn a language. So subconsciously, it is installing these beliefs. And then what happens when I want to learn a language? I really take longer. Well, they didn't really test this on language learning, but they tested it on other tasks. So they had half of the group of the same age doing tests that said, never mind the language, people over 50 can do it just as well as people under 50, for as an example, and people over 50 do just as well at exercising, things like that. And then they have them do a test, and it could even be the test that Svanja was telling this morning, you know, pressing a button to see whatever picture was belongs to what. And the ones that have had the negative messaging do worse. So that's the subconscious installing of beliefs, and that's what I try to propagate here. Let's install positiveness in everything, not just in language learning, but in everything. So there's also, of course, a moral use of a story. You can disturb a limiting view of the world. You see a behavior or attitude from a different perspective. And you can demonstrate how people respond to their map of reality, not reality itself. That reminds me of a story. Do you know Pablo Picasso? Well, I don't mean do you know him personally. If you do, is he still alive? I don't even know. No? Okay, then don't bring me in contact with him. I'll be dead. But anyway, Pablo Picasso is said to have traveled by train from Nice to Spain. And I can't tell you the story said again, it was an American. So let's say there was a Dutch person in the same coupe, in the same wagon. And the Dutch person said, aren't you Pablo Picasso? And he said, si. And he said, well, then I want to tell you something. I don't like your paintings at all because you don't paint things as they are. Okay? Said Picasso. He said, well, no, you paint these strange things, you know, the eyes and the forehead and everything is upside down. Why don't you paint things like in real life? No comprendo, said Picasso. So the Dutch guy got really angry and he said, ah, smart ass, wait a minute. And he took out his wallet from his back pocket and he took out a picture and he says, look, this is what it should be like. This is my wife, you know, and this is real life. So Picasso said, ah, sí, ahora comprendo, now I understand. Your wife is only this small and extremely thin? Okay, so that's a limiting belief of the man. It's their map of reality. It's their way of thinking. That's not necessarily true. Maybe I should explain the world map, or the word map. If you have a map of France or a map of whatever country, you see the map and you think something very different than someone else who looks at it. Because if you've been there, you know what the country tastes like, looks like, smells like, feels like, etc. The other person looks at the map and thinks, oh yeah, that's a country where people only speak French. Not true, not true. But I mean, that's, yeah, that's their map of the world. It's not the world itself. Okay, and I was also going to talk about some action metaphors. I do a lot of training myself to learn new things and not always new languages. And there was a guy who said, I do action metaphors, so I was intrigued. And I learned a lot of useful things there. This guy was telling us a story about a person who worked in a supermarket as a supervisor, and he was so busy. He was always busy. People came running in and out, and he had to look after the orders and see that his personnel worked well and things like that. And he said, oh, I'm up to here. I can't face it anymore. I'm almost having a nervous breakdown. So this trainer said, okay, I will help you. Come to me tomorrow wearing sport clothes, and we're going to the gym. Well, the gym place of a school. Okay, the man thought it was strange, but he came and he was wearing sneakers and sport clothes. So this trainer starts throwing a ball at him. He says, here's a ball. Now, you kick the ball around and keep it rolling. It's okay, this guy thinks, well, he kicks around the ball, kicks it against the wall. And the other guy says, okay, here's another ball. Now you have to keep them both rolling. The guy wasn't that smart. He didn't stay in the center of the gym. But anyway, he was kicking the two balls around and he kept them rolling. And as you can understand, more and more balls were rolled at him and he had to keep them all rolling. And of course, at some point, one of the balls just didn't roll anymore. So the trainer said, hey, stop. This ball is not rolling. And one was a basketball, and one was a volleyball, and one was a tennis ball. And he asked the guy, he said, have you got any idea what you've been doing? Yeah, I've been kicking around balls. He said, but now if I tell you, the basketball is your wife, the volleyball is your business, the tennis balls are your employees, the ping pong balls or the golf balls, whatever you had there, are your children. And then it dawned on the guy, yeah, I'm trying to keep too many balls moving in my life. It's impossible. So the guy asked him, okay, so what are you going to do about it? And then he said, well, I think I need to attend some of the balls at one time and other balls maybe at another time, not at the same time. So, well, in the end, they worked out something so that he wouldn't be disturbed all the time in the supermarket, etc., etc. Well, that is an action metaphor. And there are also many. So it's a way around his conscience, because if he would have told, the trainer would have told the supermarket guy, hey, you're trying to do too many things at a time. The guy would have said, what? No, that's my job. And come on, don't interfere with me. And, you know, he would have had resistance. But when he feels in his whole body that he's trying to do something that is impossible, then he will know. And a famous saying in NLP is like, the body speaks before the mind speaks. Your body knows. Even we know as we're sitting here, you know, if something doesn't feel good, you kind of, or your hair stands on end, why do we get all these expressions in language that have to do with our bodies? That's because the body speaks before the mind speaks. I think I still have like 15 minutes. I would like a volunteer to do an action metaphor. And I'm not going to hypnotize you. You're not going to undress unless you specifically want to. It's nothing weird. Is there anybody who would like to demonstrate something together with me here on stage? Well, not all at once. Okay. Yezhi, come here. Yeah, good. I remember your name. Because now I'm going to involve him, and it's only one. Sorry for the camera. I need you in the chair. So. Such a cavalier, such a gentleman. Sit down, please. I'm not going to hang him up. Woo! You see, this conjures up an image immediately. I don't know what you're all thinking. Come on. I just have to put this down for a moment.
So, can you please put your hands on your knees? Because I didn't have any better ropes at hand. But this is an action. Oh, can you hear me still?
Yes.
So, Michal, you could speak without a microphone.
I'll do it.
This is an action metaphor about letting go. Some people just can't let go. They want to be in control always. So, what I let them do is I say, sit down. Don't do anything that I don't want you to do, kind of. So, I think it's a bit awkward because I don't have. Well, I'll do it from this side. So I kind of go up. He's a marionette now, he's a puppet. In his case, I can feel some resistance, so I'll say, let go. There is some, yeah, you see? So I feel that he's resisting what I want to do with his arms.
I can't control it, you know?
No, you can't, yeah, that's very good.
I feel relaxed, but even if I feel relaxed, there is some resistance that...
Okay, we're getting very psychological now. But this is what I have people do, and I thought, I don't know how many people, thanks.
Yeah.
We won't go any further. This is for after dinner. Works, yes. So this is one of the action metaphors I use, and I even do things like this in class. Sometimes I have my students standing like in groups of three, so there's two people facing each other and there's one in the middle, and I say, okay, stand still and let yourself be dropped forward or pushed forward and backward and let yourself go. And then you see that they can't. They're kind of rigid and they don't let go. And I say, well, you know, what's stopping you? And slowly, when they get more confident, they also get better in learning. That reminds me of another story. Strange how everything reminds me of stories. There's this famous golf player, apparently, I don't know much about golf, Gary Player. And he was in this competition, and the ball was in a very sandy place, and it was a very, very difficult. It was not a very easy swing he had to make, so he mentally rehearsed this. And then finally, you know, he had the right club and he was rehearsing in his mind, and then he went over and he hit the ball and it was beautiful. It almost went into hole number whatever it was. And then he won the game. So he walked back to the club or whatever, and he heard someone say, "Ha ha, that was a very lucky shot." And he turned around and he addressed this person and he said, "You know what? This is a strange thing. Because I practice really hard, and the harder I practice, well, the more I practice, the better I get. And what is so funny is that the better I get, the luckier I get." So, another story. This is a very famous saying, and the funny thing is if you Google it or look for it on the internet, first it says it was an Indian saying from the Native American Indians. The other will say it was I don't know, Einstein, it's been attributed to everybody, or a Chinese saying even, whatever, you know, it says, tell me and I'll forget, show me and I might remember, so I'm sure you will remember my bondage act with Yeshe, and he will understand, because he's been involved. So metaphors, stories, also can involve people. They can involve them by, you know, keeping them curious, by keeping them wondering. And that was the slide. But of course, I didn't tell you what was in the little black box. Well, the thing is, I had been anticipating like stalling about 2 hours. I went over to this huge TV. I took the box, I opened the box, and it had a paper in it. And it said, "I knew you'd look." And this is a true story. So I thought, shoot. I thought it was really funny as well. So I put it back, and then I thought, I'm not gonna tell Luis, my boyfriend at the time. I said, I'm not going to tell him because, then he'll know I looked. I don't want him to gloat, you know, like, "I knew you'd look." I mean, it said it on the paper, and then if I would tell him, like, ha ha ha. So he came home and I resisted for about 5 seconds and I said, "Shoot, you rascal." He said, "Yeah, I looked and it was rather funny." So, at the end, he had his moment of glowing at me. And that's one of my stories. That was what I wanted to tell you.
So, you've got about 5 minutes, so you can have one or two questions if anybody's got anything they would like to ask.
Oh, they're all hypnotized.
Oh, there we go. Tell me a story.
Wait, I just want to know what you got in your real birthday.
Oh, that's good. See? Curiosity still. Curiosity killed the cat. I got a ring. It was a beautiful ring. No, he didn't cheat me. Then he would have been my ex-boyfriend even sooner. No.
Anyone else want to ask a question?
We have a head.
Yeah, sorry.
What is your metaphor of language learning? Like, language learning is like?
Ah, that's a good question. It's like a lot of things, actually, for me. So I don't think I have one metaphor. Language learning is like life, basically. It's like, well, maybe more even so, it's like interacting with people. Languages are a lot like people, they have their own character. Languages are also like music, they have their own rhythm. So for me, there's a lot of things I associate with languages. That's why I like the first speech this morning by Vanya, because it's thematic for me more than taxonomy. Yeah?
Where do you find all the stories that you've done in class? Like, do you create them or do you find them? Like,
well, I lived 52 years. No. Oh my God, what did I say? It's going to go viral now. No, I guess the more you read stories, I read a lot of stories. And, well, the first stories I heard in my life were, of course, the fairy tales that are very well known. You know, like the Sleeping Beauty, etc. And those are the more archetypical stories. But then a lot of things I think, oh, that's a good story. Even movies. Disney has a lot of the Disney cartoon movies. Or what do I say? Like Nemo, etc. Or Ratatouille about the mouse. They have a lot of stories in them. So I prefer to tell stories when I teach, but I also sometimes show stories. Have you seen on the internet Jill Balty, the La La Land thing? It's about a woman and she's actually a brain researcher. And she has this massive stroke. In the end, she had a hemorrhage the size of a golf ball in her left brain. And the way she tells it is brilliant. It's a metaphor on itself. I mean, it's not nice that she had it, but she fully recuperated. Took her about 7 years, and on the TED Talks, she talks about this in a beautiful way, and she also explains the difference between the left brain and the right brain very well. And that on its own is a metaphor, so I use whatever comes to hand, actually. Yeah? Okay. Time's up.